Hi everyone, today I'll be talking about Giblet, Docker, Cats, and Explosion, right? So BuzzFeed style, you know, because if I just put Giblet and Docker, nobody's gonna listen, so I have to put in Cats because everyone likes Cats, I think. And of course, I gotta put in Explosions, right? Just so that people will be more interested. So, but before I introduce myself and give my talk, I would like to give a quick shout out to Pieter Hingens, who was a force contributor that is very well known. He has written several books, like Zero MQ, Programmable C, and many even that Necromancer, Confessions of Necromancer. Right. So he has just recently he has passed away, and people from all over the world flew down to attend his wake. So really incredible guy, and yeah. So do check out his books if you all haven't seen it before. So a little bit myself, my name is Hui Ren, yeah. So a tagline that I have is proprietary software's worst nightmare, right? So I'm an open source evangelist and really passionate about it. But there's a bit of irony behind that, which I'll touch on that later on, right? So, and I'm also an open organization and Fedora ambassador in Singapore. So what I do at the open organization is so we talk about open management and how it's changing tech landscape of how we work in the future, right? And at Fedora, we are one of the Linux distribution that is being funded by Red Hat. Yeah. So and that's my Twitter handler there. Right. So you know, when it comes to as a software engineer, you know, people would think, oh, you know, you probably won't be attached, right? So well, I am attached, right? So I'm attached to this company called A-Star, and here at A-Star, we make the impossible possible, right? So this is a Silicon Valley reference right there, right? So then I also have a very cringy thing I do. I always give this really cringy joke. If the code works on the laptop, then we deploy the laptop to production, right? So yeah, so I actually wrote this on the whiteboard there. I'm not sure if anyone even noticed while at work. Anyway, so let's move on to the elephant in the room, right? The agenda, right? So we'll look at what is GitLab, right? And what is Docker? What is this Docker thing, right? So there's when I talk to my friend, I tell him about Docker. He thought it was a brand of shoes and clothes and apparel, right? Apparently there's this brand called Dockers, right? So we're not talking about that. We're talking about this container system thing that is a competitor to RSCM anymore. Right, and I'll talk about the pain and agony that I've endured through the entire process of using GitLab and Dockers and things like that. Right, and of course the celebrating the success of having a build test pass. Right, and of course GitLab. Right, so we have here at A-Star, we use this thing called GitLab. It's an open source Git server software which you can host it in your home or anywhere. Right. And of course, we have to use GitLab, right? Because we have to maintain our code base. So one thing about A-Star is that it's a proprietary company, right? So now you got the irony there, right? So they need to hide their code and everything, right? So everything is based on, we sell licenses, and we use this GitLab to collaborate on our code and manage our code very well, right? And we also use this thing called Docker, mainly for, currently right now it's mainly used for building and testing as only, but we are trying to push it towards more towards production use as well. And of course, the project I'm currently working on, we are using Laravel and some Node.js. Yeah, so some magic there, right? So Laravel is a, in case you all didn't know, Laravel is a PHP framework currently at PHP 5.3. Recommended running environment is PHP 7, right? Because although Laravel 5.3, it only requires version 5.6, but the components it uses, some of them requires PHP version 7, right? So although, yeah, so you have some problems if you don't run PHP 7, right? So that's something that I'll touch on later on as well. There's also this different kind of frameworks out there such as CodeIgniter and many more, right? But we won't touch on that. There's just three things that you need to remember: GitLab, Docker, and Laravel, right? So I'll now talk to you about the box of pains, right? So box is also another reference to Silicon Valley HBO, right? So this guy, the Hooli CEO, he talked about the box. Yeah, so the first pain point that I've encountered was firewalls, right? So firewall was a big pain for me, right? So in A-Star, the network is just completely firewall with some ports, you know, with some ports available, right? So, well, I use Cloud9, an IDE, an online IDE. Have you all heard of Cloud9 before, anyone? Cloud9? A few hands, yeah. So you know, it's like an online ID which you can use to collaborate real time with other people. So you can share your code with other people, your co-workers and stuff, and then collaborate in real time. So when you change one thing, it appears right there. Yeah, it just changed, right? And well, we don't have a local Cloud9 box. We don't have a local Cloud9 box, so I use the online one. But the thing is, when I use the online one and the network is firewall, of course, I cannot git commits and stuff, right? So it was a really painful thing to do, right? So, well, the solution I had was quite painful. Actually, there's a better way to do this, but I do it the easier way. So it was to get my Cloud9 code, I git committed onto GitHub, yeah? Then after that, I pull it down to my laptop, then I git push it to the GitLab server, right? So it's kind of frustrating sometimes because you can only push the code to GitLab when you are in the office itself, right? And A-Star, we do have a culture of remote working as well. Not all teams, but the team I'm in, they do have a culture of remote working. And pain number two that I have was that, you know, Laravel wasn't working, right? So it was, well, why isn't Laravel working? So when I set up GitLab and everything was set up already. I try to test my code, right? So, you know, have you all heard of the build process and testing processes? Anyone? Okay, a few hands. Right, so, GitLab has this thing called GitLab CE, which is the GitLab runner that runs the tests, right? So you might have heard of Travis, Jenkins, CircleCI, which are all test runners. So you basically you spin up a box and then you run the test code and you run through your set of tests through PHP unit or whatever test software you are using, right? So I used the PHP 7 base Docker image. The base image was really minimal. So it was so minimal to the extent whereby you basically don't have a lot of things, right? So you have to manually compile them, right? So of course, I was pretty frustrated and like this angry bird here, explosions. Yeah, so here's your first explosion image. I promise and deliver it to you, right? So the solution is to fetch the base image and then compile the necessary components, right? So we fetched the base image from Docker and then we did a compilation on GitLab, right? It sounds like a normal because a normal thing to do, right? And it sounds sane, right? We have a server, the server has 8 cores, right? So it shouldn't be an issue, right? And it has plenty of RAM, plenty of hard disk space as well, right? Shouldn't be an issue, right? But it is still an issue, right? Because the Docker building process was quite slow because the bottleneck wasn't on the core, wasn't on the memory, wasn't on the hard disk, but rather on the network. The network was awfully, awfully slow, right? It was so ridiculous. It's so slow, right? It took 15 minutes to get one Docker image built, finished, right? So that was how ridiculously slow it was, right? When I waited for the Docker image to build, I almost died. Look at this skeleton here. And of course, I always know how to manage my time very well, right? Like any developers, you know, when the Docker image is being built, we spend our time looking at cat pictures online, right? So exotic cats, short hair cats, exotic short hair, long hair. Oh, and Olivia Benson, which is Taylor Swift's cat, right? So we spend our time meaningfully looking at cat pictures, right? Don't tell that to my supervisor, or else I won't be able to enter the office tomorrow, right? I hope he's not watching this right now. Anyway, what was the solution was I created a Docker file with the PHP being compiled and everything. So it's on Git. It's on GitHub, right? So the URL is here, github.com/giantcrab. Don't ask me. Okay, I'll tell you why giant crab, right? So I have this fascination for crabs and especially giant ones. So I put up my nickname as giant crab, right? Not So remember, it's a B, not a P, right? Important alphabet there. So I set up this Laravel environment. What it does is that it apt-gets, install, updates all these necessary components which are needed to compile PHP, right? So what I did was I grabbed all these dependencies that and then compiled PHP, right? That was why. So there was still some pain, right? Pain is never ending, right? So I encountered an issue, right? So, you know, I have the PHP part up already, but what about MySQL part, right? We need a database, right? Right. So, but you know, it wasn't working. So I couldn't figure out what was even wrong, right? I couldn't, there was no absolute idea. And I complained to my coworker, King Hui, about it and asked him, hey, why isn't it working? Let's look at the error logs and everything. But it was not very helpful, the error logs. So we tried both the official Docker image and the Oracle maintained one. And build test fail, build fail, build fail, build continuously fail, and I cancel them several times. You can see how painful it is, right? So flip table, explosions and many more, right? So it was a very silly mistake. And the solution was to use the official Docker image and set the host name to MySQL. What do I mean by that? I'll show you later. But don't use the Oracle image as part of service, because the Oracle maintained image as a service, it doesn't work, right? Don't ask me why it doesn't work. It doesn't run as a service, right? The Oracle maintained one just doesn't work. Only the Docker one did. So this was the part in Laravel, there's this thing called the Laravel environment. So where you can set up all your database connections. So notice that the DB host here is 127.0.0.1, which is pointing to a local host, right? So how Docker works is you need to spin up several Docker, the number of Dockers to the number equivalent of services you need, right? So I need PHP and I need MySQL. So what I do is I need to spin up two services, right? So PHP and MySQL. So what I needed to do was to point towards the MySQL server, and it was fixed using this, right? So I set the DB host to MySQL, and voila, fixed, right? So it was, although it's a small mistake, it caused quite a lot of headache, you know. And of course, after that, unit test passed, right? Fantastic job, right? But is it really the end of everything, right? Is it ready to ship, right? Well, as developers, we always hold on to this mantra, which, you know, even though it's good enough to ship, we've got the race to quality is there, right? We need to have high quality, right? So pain number five, right? So the network was still pretty slow. So I had to, you know, it took around 10 minutes actually to compile. Okay, so the Docker part is already done. The Docker image for PHP is already done and everything. But I still have to download the Laravel dependencies, right? So Laravel has a set of dependencies in download and everything. So what I did was, the network was really, really, really shitty and really slow, and it's ridiculous, right? So it gets me on explosions, ba-boom! Another explosion picture here. So as promised, as delivered, right? So what I did was I pre-packaged Docker with the Laravel dependencies. So when the Docker image is building and everything, after it builds finish and compiles finish, it will then start downloading the Laravel dependencies accordingly, right? So it saves a lot of time, right? Because the Docker network is obviously a lot faster than the office network, right? So this was what it was inside, some parts which was inside. So I'll briefly explain to you what I'm doing right here. So I'm changing directory to the user directory, which is just slash root. So it's not slash home slash root. Right, it's special for Docker because it's really alpine is a really minimal thing, right? So, and you know, as a best practice, you shouldn't be running as root, but I still am, because yeah. Anyway, I changed my current directory to the slash root, and then I downloaded the composer file from Laravel. And then I downloaded the composer. I downloaded the composer, and then I piped it. I piped it to do a installation of whatever the Laravel composer dependencies, right? So all the dependencies will be downloaded, and then yeah, and that was, so all the stuff are already pre-packaged, right? So notice that this kind of stuff, like no autoloader and no scripts and no suggests, right? So this is really important because you don't have the auto-loading stuff, because I only just downloaded the composer file, which is just a single file that lists out the dependencies, right? I didn't download any the auto-loaders or anything else, right? I only just downloaded the dependencies, so I don't want it to run auto-loading after installation has been done, right? So yeah, and this was what I did later on. So I need to move the composer file. I need to move the composer log file, and of course move the downloaded dependencies, right? So all the Laravel dependencies are downloaded in this folder called /vendor, right? So all these are the dependencies location, and I move it to the current. This is what I run in GitLab. So these are the commands I run in GitLab before it runs the unit test, right? And of course there are after pain and agony and all that, there's always learning points, right? So because life is a lifelong learning journey, something like that, right? So very politically correct right now. So always try to remain calm, you know, even when things are not working out well. Try to look at cat pictures. So what I do is when I'm frustrated and something, right, I always look at cat pictures, and it kind of de-stress me sometimes, I guess. And of course, I drink plenty of water to keep myself hydrated. And talk to people, right? You can curse, think, celebrate with them. And remember to always have fun, right? So it's always important to always have fun when doing this kind of things, right? Because if you ultimately, at the end of the day, you're not having fun, I don't know what you're having, right? You're having stress, right, probably. So I talked to Ting Hui, which is one of my co-workers. So I always curse with him about how GitLab is painful and everything. And of course, most importantly, give a talk to share memorable experience on the memorable experiences with GitLab, Docker, and PHP, right? And of course, just a shout out to him as well. So he's getting married soon, so I'm giving him a shout out so that he'll invite me to his wedding, hopefully. Yeah, so his Twitter is Iced Water, right? And let me end off with a quote from, not the quote yet. So the next steps, right? So one of the next steps I need to do is I want to create my own Laravel dependencies, so to do some other things that, you know, I need to do, right? So I'll open source them as well, most importantly, because those are not the core components which A*STAR is interested in selling. So I'll just create them as open source projects and hope that ETPR would not chase after me, right? And of course, I'm intending to do continuous deployment. So right now it's just a continuous integration with GitLab and Docker, testing and everything, build, test, pass, things like that, right? So after that, we need to deploy it, right? So there's this thing called OpenShift by Red Hat. So you can actually download OpenShift onto your local server and local laptop, and then bring up the entire orchestration. You orchestrate the entire Docker army, right? So there's currently a war between Docker Swarm and Kubernetes and OpenShift and all that kind of orchestration tools out there, right? So even Mesos, right? So everyone has been fighting between, oh, which is the best orchestration tool, right? But OpenShift you can just download, and then you can also run Docker Swarm, but that is not really, I don't think it's really up to the point which you can actually deploy it into production. OpenShift is relatively well supported by Red Hat, right? So Red Hat is a really, they are not doing open source just for fun, right? They are doing open source to feed their entire family, right? And of course, I want to do more hashing and denormalization. So it's always important to denormalize your data and everything, so that your data will be cached, right? So I read an article about how denormalization is dead, and then Josh replied, oh, demoralization isn't broken, we call it NoSQL these days. Jokes aside, check out CQRS. So I think CQRS is related to Microsoft, so shout out to Microsoft as well, right? So yeah, so this he's just joking about how NoSQL, yeah. Anyway, so I think this is the part where the code is coming in, right? So I would like to end off with a really, really philosophical quote that, you know, all presenters must have, right, at the end of each presentation, so that everyone will feel like they have been enlightened by me. Right, so the quote from Pieter Hingens, right, make one change, test one change, layer your code and write self-test so that when it works, it always works. Use print statement in towards APIs, blah, 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 right? So what he's trying to say here was that, you know, always try to write code that are fully testable, right? Because at the end of the day, if let's say you were to die today, right? Who is gonna understand your code, right? Right, someone has to understand your code, and you're making sure, and you're bringing down that person who's actually reading your code, right? You're already dead. Don't make other people die as well. Right, so really important to write testable code and have a architecture that is really fully modular and that allows people to make change effectively and test if the change works. Right, so that's all for my talk. Really good book from Pieter Hingens, actually. It's also open source, I think. It's on gitbook.io. You can check out his book, Confessions of a Necromancer. It talks about even from the basic programmers and all the way to the experts. It's a really, really great book you should check out, right? So, yeah, you can email me or tweet to me. I'm on Facebook, Twitter, and RSFM. RSFM for people who want to ask questions, but they are too shy to ask. So, anyone has any questions? No questions?
You're not going to have a table or explosion moment?
Explosion moment, right, so... Oh, it's... I've not tried MariaDB yet, and there was actually a controversial behind MariaDB, right? So, you know, MariaDB was a fork of MySQL because they were afraid that Oracle would make it proprietary, would make MySQL proprietary and screw everyone again, which Oracle always does. But just a few months ago, MariaDB just went into proprietary. Yeah, some major site components were made proprietary, but the philosophy behind, they actually just blew up their own philosophy actually. But the MariaDB itself is still open source, just that the components that were quite important were moved from open source to become proprietary, and they have their so-called enterprise version. Right. Anyway, aside of that, I've never tried MariaDB yet, but it should. I've never tried MariaDB on Docker, but I've run MariaDB on normal Linux distribution, and it's quite well. It works quite well, and it's pretty much just like a MySQL, right?
You
have CI to
pipelines.
Yeah,
pipelines.
After
you pass the test, the next step?
Deploy, yeah.
You know you can also build your Docker containers on Docker
Hub? Yeah, I'm doing it on the Docker Hub. Oh, yeah. So, previously when I did it on GitLab itself, it just took 15 minutes.
Do you try considering committing the whole vendor folder?
Committing
the whole vendor folder into the
repo. So I could do that, but I don't think it's really that good because you know the dependencies might change and everything.
But
and
you're testing that one snapshot.
Yeah. I'm testing that one single snapshot. I could just commit the entire vendor folder as well. But I guess I didn't do it because it's so-called the more right way, I don't know. Yeah, so usually people don't commit the vendor folder, they put it under a git ignore, and then like right now it would make sense for me to commit the vendor folder, right? It would totally make sense. But I forgot there were some things that I wanted to do, then there were some constraints that which I forgot already. Then I didn't download the vendor. Instead, I went to download the dependencies via Composer. Yeah.
Did you try using caches? Cache
for
set up cache
folders. Yeah. The cache is already set up by King Hui, I think. So he's running Redis cache as well, and some cache other stuff. So when it pulls the Docker image and then it leaves it there. Yeah, the base image is stored there, and then it'll check if the image has been changed, and then if it has been changed, right, it'll pull a new version. But if it has not been changed, it'll use a local version.
I'm talking about the vendor folder.
Oh, the vendor. Yeah. There were some scenarios which I, when I used cache, right, when I did some caching, like some, I remember this was one gotcha that I had. I run PHP artisan cache, config cache, and then it failed my test because of reasons, right? I don't know why, it just failed test, so I had to clear the cache. And some stuff just can't be cached, or else it'll just screw up. I don't know why. It's kind of weird. Any question?
How slow is the A-star network?
How slow is it? I've never done a speed test actually, but it was it wasn't super fast. Hopefully, you know, the people from A-Star won't be watching this, right? Alright.
So one question. Your unit test, do you really quit hit the database?
Okay, yes. I don't do mocking. So it does hit the database. So I use this thing called I run use database transactions. So every time it goes through one test, right, the transaction record is then removed. Right, so I didn't do mocking for the database part. Yeah, it's there's always pros and cons to using mocking for databases, but I think there's certainly some things that you should do mocking. Like let's say if you want to do a test to let's say the PHP, I don't know, the Facebook API, it would make sense to do some mocking of the data, so that you won't actually go and make a real request to the Facebook server and all that. Yeah. Any more questions? No? I think that's it. Thank you.